good afternoon to all of you. It's a great pleasure to be back today. Each time I come here, I find the city more dynamic and more vibrant, and it's really, really great. I would also like to thank very much ASRTU for inviting UICP to share our views on the organization and the regulation of public transport, and but also for the strong partnership that we established in India for the good development of public transport in the country. So UICP is a global network bringing together the urban public transport community with a very dynamic office in India led by my predecessor Singh, and that I'm sure most of you may know. So it's not easy to there are many ways to organize and to regulate public transport. And it's not easy to choose which way, which lane we take. There is not a perfect model. There is not even a single model for the organization and the regulation of public transport. Of course, this is probably related to the history, the culture, and to the governance of the country. So in the context of India, where the population is growing very fast, but the economy is growing very fast, where there is an increasing competition from the private vehicles, where we see the fast development of new mobility services, it's quite an urgent task to reform the public transport to keep its attractiveness. So my presentation will be a very short and a very simple one. I will not go into many details. I would just like to set out the framework for the discussion of the panel that will follow the presentation. So creating a high quality and integrated and efficient public transport system can only be achieved when we have strong transport authorities that are in place. And the national, the regional, and the local government all have a strong role to play to organize public transport, as it cannot be left to the market alone. So public transport needs to be regulated and, more importantly, planned, organized, and supervised. As I said at the beginning, several models can be applied, but it all starts with setting those right conditions. If we do a quick tour around the world, we see that there are many cities where public transport is working well, it's efficient, and it's successful. Here you see some of the cities in London, in Guangzhou, in Sofia, Singapore, Amsterdam, Vancouver, Lagos, Madrid, Abu Dhabi. There are many more cities with efficient public transport system. But what do the cities have in common? And why is public transport working well in those cities? Well, first of all, in those cities, public transport is well organized at the city or at the metropolitan level. So we see in London, in Madrid, in Lagos, there is a transport authority for the metropolitan area that is responsible for organizing mobility within the city, within the metropolitan area. The second common element of the city is that public transport is regulated and is supported by appropriate, adequate legislation at the national and at the regional level. We see in China, in Canada, in Malaysia, there are national policy frameworks that support the organization of public transport. The third common point of the successful cities is that they are well-defined financing schemes that are in place. In Oslo, in Tokyo, in Vancouver, there are stable funding mechanisms for public transport. And finally, another common point of the successful cities is that there are clear contracts between the regulator and the transport operators. And we see this, for instance, in London and in Singapore and in many other cities. What is also very important is that there needs to be, at the level of the city, or the metro, a vision of the role of public transport and political support for the development of public transport. So, what do we see here? We see here that for a house to be stable, we need to have good foundations. And if I want to do this analogy with showing the house of public transport. For public transport to be stable, we need a number of pillars to be in place. They start with organization, let's say, with strong local or regional transport authorities that manage mobility in the city and the metropolitan area. But we also need to have legislation in place, legislation at the national or the regional level that supports the functioning of those authorities. And we also need to have financing models that are in place to support the actual functioning of public transport. If one of the pillars is missing, what is happening is that the house of public transport cannot work efficiently. If we don't have a proper legislative framework that supports the local transport authorities to actually play the role, well, public transport will not be able to work efficiently. It's not all. We also need to have implementation capacity at the local level. Public transport without implementation capacity at the local level is like having a house without a roof. So it's very important that we have mayors, local decision makers that have the capability to implement public transport systems and public transport measures. And we also need to have political support. Public transport without political support is like a house without foundations. And so we need all those elements to be in place for public transport to work successfully. So it will be very interesting to hear in the debate between the panelists what they feel is present and what they feel is not present currently in public transport in India. I believe that with recent program, the GNR program, or the one smart cities, we have good financing in some place. We also have, in some cities, good organizational frameworks that are in place. We need to discuss with the panelists if they feel that the legislation is sufficient to support the development and the functioning of those local transport authorities. So, taking a snapshot of public transport forward, we see that we have very different situations. But in general, what we see is that the cities where public transport is working more efficiently are cities where we combine good organization, efficient legislation, and stable financial support for public transport. And we see that in many parts of the world, some of those elements are present, but not all of them. And this is something which is necessary to be able to combine those three elements, plus political support, plus implementation capacity. So I'm trying to also try to launch the discussion that will be the last slide of the presentation. I think some thoughts about what would be a typical reform agenda for public transport, starting at the level of the regulation or the legislation. So it is necessary to have a regulatory framework at the national or the regional level to give some mandates to metropolitan or local transport authorities. And we need to have simple frameworks that are based on the principle of delegation to private operators that will be regulated by the authority. And that might need some reforms in terms of the law that govern the transport at the national or the state level. So the second level is the level of the institutional level organizations. So we need for each city, for each metropolitan area, one entity that is possible for all aspects of urban mobility, from the planning, the management, the supervision, and the financing of public transport. And also, why can't public transport be able to look at urban planning, parking, and other aspects that are linked to public transport policy? So here, the action that required is the setting up of local or metropolitan transport authorities or transport agencies. And then the third element is on the financial level, so we need to have clear and stable funding schemes for public transport, looking at both the operations on a daily basis, also the investment for public transport. And this can be achieved by many ways. For instance, having a transport fund at the city level, or at least to have the local authorities and the regional authorities with the capability to generate the funding that is required for public transport, and not being dependent on funding that comes from other level of governance without a direct link to the needs that they have and the plans that they have at the local level. So this is only the end of the presentation. I promise it will be a short one, and I hope that you help to set a framework for the discussion we have with the excellent panel we have. Thank you very much for your attention.